Hello, aspirants. Looking at current affairs for 17th August, the news items picked up from the Hindu newspaper are these 14. We'll look at them in detail. The first one, Gorakhpur deaths not due to lack of oxygen, says panel. So this is regarding the same BRD Medical College Hospital of Gorakhpur, Uttar Pradesh, the case where children have died due to acute encephalitis syndrome. We have already seen the details regarding this. You know about encephalitis. One of the forms is Japanese encephalitis, which is caused due to Culex mosquitoes. The flavivirus is spread through the vector is the Culex mosquito. So here now a three-member central government committee had been established, and it has stated that this deaths did not take place due to shortage of oxygen supply. Even Padma Supplies, the company which was providing these cylinders, had stated that there was no stopping of the supply as such, which was not undertaken. So the private contractor did not stop supply of oxygen. Then the next news item is, the next is 15 to 29% of AES fatality rate at BRD hospitals. So acute encephalitis syndrome has a high fatality rate. You can see 15 to 29% of all cases. It's a data over a span of 8 years, which has been seen that such people and majorly the children who are affected by acute encephalitis syndrome, they die in this hospital, because as we have seen earlier too, the children who reach here, they are in later stages of advancement of the disease. So that is also a reason why the fatalities are high, and this also reflects the lack of adequate medical facilities at other regions beyond, no, lower than the district level. So this is a district hospital which is there. Even adjoining districts and people from Nepal also arrive here in BRD Medical College Hospital of Gorakhpur. So there is a need for strong public healthcare centers and diagnostic tests which should be available here, so that the disease can be detected earlier and treatment initiated. So this is the data regarding the fatalities. You can see the deaths, number of deaths which occurred in UP are shown in light blue, and number of deaths at BRD Medical College Hospital are shown in dark blue. So majority of the deaths which are there are taking place in this hospital only. So then next is, Supreme Court tells NIA to probe Kerala love jihad case. So this is a case in Kerala where a Hindu girl married a Muslim man, and now the family of this girl has, the girl is back with the family, with her parents, and the parents have approached the court here because they say that this is an alleged case of radicalization and conversion of this Hindu girl by this man. So it has also been stated by NIA, National Investigation Agency, earlier that this is not a one-off case. They have also come across another case with a similar pattern and involving same persons as instigators. So that is why now the Supreme Court has asked the NIA to investigate into the matter. So NIA is going to investigate, National Investigation Agency, which is a terror agency which looks into investigation of terror cases. So it is going to investigate and give its report to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court has also appointed a judge. You can see a former Supreme Court judge, Justice Ravindran, has been appointed to supervise the NIA probe to ensure that it is fair. So this is a step which has been taken by the Supreme Court. The advocate for the Muslim man, they have asked the Supreme Court to speak to the Hindu girl first and come to know whether the marriage had been with her consent or not. But the Supreme Court has stated that if the girl says that marriage was against her wishes, then the case is closed. So they want the NIA to probe this case first. This has been a point of controversy that the girl has not been spoken to before this whole case has been given a wide angle. Then next is, India has 27,312 elephants, census shows. So this is the census which has been given, a first ever synchronized all India elephant population estimate. So this has come to 27,312 Asian elephants which India has, and this is based on two techniques. One is direct count method, directly counting the elephants, and another is an indirect method called dung count method. So the dung as such is seen, and based on that the animals, number of animals are counted. So here you can see in India the maximum population of elephants is in the state of Karnataka, then comes Assam, and then Kerala. The previous census of elephants was in 2012. So animal censuses are conducted every 5 years, while population censuses of the people here is conducted every 10 years. So in 2012, the last census which was conducted showed a larger number of elephants, but then it is said that that census was not synchronized. So since the 2012 census was not synchronized, it can be an error and duplication of, you know, overestimation could have taken place of the elephant population. This is there. It has been stated by the director of Project Elephant. So the way we have Project Tiger, Project Elephant had also been initiated by the government. The director here says that there has been a marginal increase in elephant numbers for sure, because even the elephants are moving out to agricultural landscapes and there is an increased man-elephant conflict. And the Project Elephant director himself is saying that elephant population needs to be checked. So this is the fact here. You can see the elephant corridors in India are also shown here, which are majorly located here in Karnataka. As we said, maximum number of elephants are also in Karnataka, then in the northeast here. Then next is Cabinet clears stalled Bihar Dam project. So this is North Koyal Reservoir project of Bihar. This has been stalled for long now. It has been stalled since 1993. So it is to provide irrigation to some of the most backward and drought-prone regions in Jharkhand and Bihar. But now the government has revived it. It will be comprising of construction of this dam, Mandal Dam. And the reason why it has been delayed for so long is because if this dam is constructed, portions of Betla National Park and Palmau Tiger Reserve in Bihar, they would be submerged to some extent. So there will be partial submergence of these regions and these national parks. That's why the project has been delayed, but now the central government has approved it, has decided to revive it, and it has stated that the Mandal Dam will be, you know, the height of the dam would be reduced to some extent, so there will be minimal submergence. A similar case is also there of Ken Betwa River Linking Project, which we have discussed quite often. You should be knowing about it by now. The Panna Tiger Reserve of Madhya Pradesh would be partially submerged, a region would be submerged because of this project, and which has got a go ahead now. So this is another project which has been revived. So here you can see a power project would also be initiated as part of this original design, but that power project has been scrapped for now. So this is the whole detail. It's on the North Koyal River here. Earlier it was in 1993 stopped by the Bihar Forest Department. Then next is none to blame for Vemula's death center. So the government, central government, had appointed this Justice A.K. Rupanwal Commission, a one-member commission, to look into the death of Rohit Vemula, a University of Hyderabad research scholar who committed suicide. So here the committee has now given its report, and it says that this suicide, no one has to be blamed for this suicide, and the central government has accepted this one member commission report, and it says there is no further action required on this matter now. So some of the recommendations which have been given by this committee to look into such cases of suicides. So there are some aspects which have to be, you know, you can see the recommendations are given here. But for the particular case of Rohit Vemula's suicide, the Justice Rupanwal Commission report says that it did not relate to activities of the university administration or political leaders. It was wholly a decision of Rohit Vemula, the person himself. So this, he says that he was having his own feelings of frustrations for reasons best known to him. So there was a controversy regarding whether Rohit Vemula is an OBC or an SC, scheduled caste, because he had claimed to be a Dalit. He was Dalit, fighting for Dalit rights too, but then the central government has been claiming that he was actually an OBC. So that is also one another aspect of it. Some recommendations which this Rupanwal Commission gave, you can see the recommendations are that university should evolve a mechanism where students can appeal in case there is an excess in university. So though Rohit Vemula's particular case, they say there was no excess in university, but then they are saying that there should be such a mechanism in place. Then they are saying there should be counseling centers set up with professionally trained counselors. There should be monitoring committees headed by supervisors to provide guidance on matters related to subjects studied by students. There should also be an equal opportunity cell in the university and anti-discrimination officers appointed. So government in its action taken report says it has agreed to all the recommendations of Rupanwal committee, and it has forwarded these to University Grants Commission and has requested it to issue suitable instructions to all central universities, including University of Hyderabad. So this is the government's stand. The suicide case, we'll look into the suicide case also. So this Rohit Vemula, he was a PhD student in University of Hyderabad. He has also written a book, Caste is Not a Rumor. So he was a student activist. He was a member of Ambedkar Students Association. And he committed suicide on 17th Jan 2016, that is last year. So his death was a controversy for several months because it all started earlier. It was from 2015, July 2015, that the incidents started happening. The university had stopped paying him his fellowship. He had a fellowship of rupees 25,000 per month. This was not being paid to him since July 2015. He had raised issues under the banner of Ambedkar Students Association, and the institute's disciplinary inquiry had looked into the matter and had taken this decision that his fellowship should be stopped. So this per month fellowship was not receiving, and also the cases were regarding him, the Ambedkar Students Association activists demonstrating against the death penalty. So the death penalty is protested against by various entities. It is internationally also a case that death penalty should be scrapped. So when Yakub Memon, a convicted terrorist, was sentenced to death, there were protests in various regions against the death penalty as such. Then there was, so this was condemned by another association, students association, that is linked to BJP, that is Akhil Bharatiya Vidyarthi Parishad. So they attacked as such the Ambedkar Students Association demonstrations. Also there was the screening of Muzaffar Nagar Baki Hai, a documentary in Delhi University. So this screening was also attacked by ABVP activists. So this Muzaffar Nagar is regarding the Muzaffar Nagar riots in UP, which has resulted in exodus of the Muslim population from this region. They are living in, you know, makeshift camps now. So this is also a case. So here they are saying, the ABVP activists say that they had written a letter to Union Minister saying that ASA members are indulging in casteist and anti-national activities. So these have been termed as anti-national activities by them, and in this letter they also, which was forwarded to HRD Minister then Smriti Irani, and the university's Vice Chancellor also received the letter. And after that, Rohit Vemula and four of his other members of Ambedkar Students Association were suspended and barred from their hostels. So they were not allowed to stay in the hostel too. They were removed from the hostel as well. So this suspension as such was confirmed in January 2016, and after that Rohit Vemula committed suicide. So this was the whole background of his suicide, and which resulted in protests and an inquiry committee being established. But the committee says that the suicide's reason were reasons best known to Rohit Vemula himself. It had nothing to do with political, that had no political angle, and the university's actions were not responsible. So this is the whole background. Then next is Union Cabinet approves new metro rail policy. So the Government of India has come up with a new policy which has presently been approved by the Union Cabinet for expanding and regulating metro rail services in cities across India. So this is the first time that such a policy for metro rail operations has been initiated. The first plan of, you know, metro rail operations in Delhi began in 2002, which is still being expanded. And now you can see here, the major aspect of this policy is regarding the funding pattern. The policy says that private participation is mandatory for all the three funding options for metro rails. So this is one of the provisions. So whether it is a PPP model with central assistance under the viability gap funding scheme, so that will also require private participation mandatory. Even if it is a grant from the center, under which 10% of the project cost is given as a lump sum, here also private participation would be mandatory. And even if it is a 50-50 equity sharing model between the central and state government, still private participation would be mandatory. So this is there. So either it can be in the for complete provision of metro rails, or even for some components of the project. So like automatic fare collection, one aspect, one of the components which is there, an essential component in metro rail projects. So there can be private participation sought in this. Then Next is the policy also says that metro projects should be initiated for sound reasons. So this is correct that if a metro project proposal is initiated, then there should be a reason why it is initiated, because there are many cases where lack of passenger traffic is resulting in such metro projects going into losses, like the Vijayawada case is highlighted. So this one aspect is also there, that there should be sound reasons. Also, it says that every metro rail proposal should also include proposals for feeder systems. So you are providing connectivity through metro rails, but then further reach out should also be there. So the catchment area of each metro station should be of at least, increased to at least 5 kilometers. So this also is a part of it. So there should be a unified metropolitan transport authority established. So this should be a statutory body entrusted with preparing a comprehensive mobility plan. So a comprehensive mobility plan means it should be reaching out to further areas, to further connectivity also being provided. So you can see that, and it should be seen whether it is cost effective or not, too. Whether there should be a metro initiated or whether it can be through mass rapid transit systems such as tramways or bus rapid transit systems which can function. So which are the best possible option to be selected for increasing transportation services should be seen, and then only it should be decided. So this is the Unified Metropolitan Transport Authority. So it will prepare a comprehensive mobility plan for the city. Then next is that states should adopt innovative mechanisms that how these metro projects should be funded. So for that, the central government in this policy is suggesting some new ways to provide financing for such projects. It says you can consider value capture financing and betterment levy to mobilize to get funding for the projects like metro projects. So what are these two terminologies? Of course, these are taxation from the people in the region who would benefit from these metro projects. So since when metro projects are initiated, the land value in those regions increase. So because the people here are benefiting, there should be a tax levied on them, value capture financing or a betterment levy, and that should be used to fund the project. So this is a suggestion in this policy by the central government to the states. Also, in case where states opt for central assistance of 10% of project cost, the union government will not concern itself with the project execution. So, though the government will provide assistance, execution will be the responsibility of the states only. This is also mentioned in the policy. And finally, it says that metros should not turn into white elephants. So, that is why rate of return has been increased. So, from current 8%, they have increased the rate of return to 14%. So there should be some returns on these investments too in metro projects. So here you can see models for private sector participation are given here. And this is regarding the betterment levy and the value capture financing. So tax that state collects on a plot of land that its actions have in some way made better. So we have made this land better, so a tax is collected. And value capture financing is also similarly a public finance, a type of public financing, means taxes from the people that recovers some or all of the value of public infrastructure generated for private landowners. So private landowners have got some public infrastructure. So that's why this value capture financing is a tax again imposed. Then next is stones flew amid water tussle in Ladakh. So this is regarding the standoff between Indian and Chinese troops. So in this Ladakh region now, pelting of stones were seen on Independence Day. So the two sides have held the flag meeting at the border personnel meeting point and at Chusul in eastern Ladakh. So this took place, but still these stone pelting incident has been a cause of concern. So a top government source has said that situation along the LAC in Ladakh has been deteriorating since April 2017, as we see that the standoff which has been initiated in Doklam region in the northeastern Sikkim region, but then even along the entire LAC in Ladakh region as well too, we are seeing that the standoff is being seen. So if China initiates action, it would initiate in such a region where it is in a more powerful position. So that is where there are concerns also raised here because of this extended standoff which is there going on between India and China. So there are these border personnel meeting points between India and China along the LAC. So here the regions as such are mentioned. So these are, you can see one is in Arunachal Pradesh, one in Ladakh Chushul, means in Jammu and Kashmir only, Ladakh. So there are three in this region. You can see Daulatbeg, Orli and Chushul. And then the fifth one is Nathula in Sikkim. So these are the border personal meeting points between India and China. There are talks of setting up another border personal meeting point in Uttarakhand. Then next is smartphones under scanner for leaking data. So the central government is now concerned regarding Indian mobile phone users' contact lists, details and text messages being leaked to other countries, including to China. So the government has asked all firms selling smartphone handsets in the country to share details of the processes they follow to ensure that there is no possibility of data thefts or leakages from their devices. So this has been initiated because it is said there are embedded programs in the smartphones which are brought. So here the operating system, the browser, the preloaded applications, whether there is any leak of data which is taking place because of this is to be inquired into, and the government has initiated on this matter. So if data, it is saying that data is the most important resource today. So if we cannot ignore if any such data has been leaked to a third country, be it China or any other country. So that is why investigation would take place in this matter too. Initiated by the corporates, the mobile phone companies themselves first giving the details. So there is a provision under section 43A of Information Technology Act also, which puts the onus on corporates to secure the data in their possession. And if there is any breach of data, then they have to pay the compensation for this breach or theft of data. Then next is Turkey warns against Iraq's Kurdish referendum. So in Iraq, this semi-autonomous Kurdish region has decided to go for a referendum to decide whether it wants to be part of Iraq or secede, means leave Iraq. So this has been protested against by Turkey, which has a large Kurdish population and is fighting with the Kurdish rebels itself. So an independent Kurdish state, if it establishes from Iraq, then there will be such demands from Turkey as well. So this is a concern here. Then next is UK seeks to work together with India over North Korean crisis. So we know about the North Korean crisis between USA and North Korea. So the Chinese government is said to be the closest to North Korea. So Britain seeks to work with India to influence China so that it can further exercise economic pressure to achieve diplomatic resolution of this crisis. So this was a stand taken in which India was also involved in this matter by Britain. Then next is India aims to widen oil import sources. So India wants to widen its oil import sources because we have already seen this, that we have started importing oil from USA. So first ever shale oil order also was brought from USA. So this is because it has been stated now that the prices of oil from USA is very competitive, and also when compared to oil from Gulf nations, from OPEC countries, this is competitive. Means this is, we are getting at the same price or even a lower price. So that is why we are initiating and diversifying our oil resources, import of oils. So this is a step taken because even Petroleum Minister Mr. Dharmendra Pradhan has quite often reiterated that OPEC countries, which are charging this Asian premium on oil prices for Asian countries, has to be eliminated. Rather, he says there should be a concession given, but they are charging extra, a premium on oil provided to Asian countries. So of course, we have been protesting against this. This has significantly reduced, but there is further elimination sought by India now. So this is regarding that. The oil from US, which is coming to India, is under free on board. This is not under free on board model. So free on board model is actually delivery of the item is taken as soon as it leaves the seller's shores. But in this case from USA, the oil is being transported by PetroChina. So it has taken this responsibility on behalf of US companies, and it is providing oil. The shipping costs is taken care of by them, and they are providing oil to us. So this is the case. And under free on board model, on the other hand, the shipping costs are borne by the buyer. So this is the general model which is followed. But in this case, PetroChina is transporting the oil on behalf of US companies for shale oil. Then next is Air India shows interest in overhauling defense planes. So the Civil Aviation Ministry has written to the Defense Ministry that Air India's MRO facilities, we have already seen regarding this, there were plans to even, you know, there were requests as such from India's oldest private sector MRO, maintenance, repair and overhaul company, to have a stake in Air India Engineering Services Limited. So now a proposal has come from Civil Aviation Ministry to the Defense Ministry that Air India Engineering Services Limited can provide MRO facilities to defense aircrafts as well. So this is a proposal. So actually, original equipment manufacturers have to give the training and maintenance manuals. If they provide these, then we can provide the MRO facilities here too. So we have the capabilities, we are doing it for the private sector, for commercial aircrafts like Boeing and Airbus fleet. So we can provide it for defense aircrafts too, provided we are given the training and maintenance manuals, which original equipment manufacturers, the equipment manufacturer, because these defense aircrafts are imported. So they do not provide these details. So that is why it becomes difficult to for MRO for these defense aircrafts. But if it is provided, then it will become cheaper for us. We can do it within the country in better turnaround time. So time will also be required, be less, and also costs will be low. So this is a proposal to the Defense Ministry. It's asking to take the proposal further too and get these manuals from these original equipment manufacturers. So even with Russia, there are talks which will be initiated. Then next is the last one. SpaceX Dragon docks in International Space Station. So the International Space Station, the artificial station which has been established where even astronauts are docked, here has seen a shipment coming from SpaceX, which is a private sector space company. So this Dragon capsule has reached here. It was launched from Cape Canaveral in USA, and it has 3 tons of cargo which it has brought for the astronauts here, which are conducting scientific experiments here. So the load which they are carrying is comprising of cosmic ray monitor, even a mini satellite, and also 20 mice for various studies. So this is the 12th Dragon capsule which has reached International Space Station. They were contracted by NASA. So there's another, this was the original agreement, the last one is pending, and there is a new deal also underway, because NASA has retired its space shuttles. So the space shuttles are no more functioning. That's why it's seeking assistance from the private space companies. So SpaceX is one of them, and the other one is Orbital ATK. So they are providing services to NASA now to send cargo and astronauts to space. And Russia, of course, is also part of International Space Station. So it also has its spacecrafts where it sends astronauts in space. So this is there. So these are the news items. Thank you.